Good morning. I'm Pastor Michael Thompson DeGrief, and I serve here at Trinity with Pastor Kim Biery. And in the name of Jesus Christ, I welcome you to worship this morning. It's so great to see so many of you here. You're in for a treat with a lot of special music, and I know that's why you're here. So that's wonderful. A couple of quick announcements. I want to let you know that we welcome all people as children of God, and we believe that every person is worthy of dignity, respect, and love. I want to invite you to fill out the attendance registers that are at the end of the pew and pass those down. And if you see someone you don't know, you might look at the name on the register and introduce yourself and welcome them. I want to let you know that today the United Women in Faith are having a bake sale. Look at this. They have caramel corn, or as my wife would say, caramel corn. But there's cookies and all kinds of wonderful treats. But I brought this to entice you. Actually, I bought this for myself, and Kim said you should hold it up. So Kim's the marketer there. Good job. But it supports the work of the United Women in Faith, so please stop by there and support them. This Wednesday, we will have our Advent Festival. We're really excited about that. It'll start at 5:45. We will feed you. We'll have crafts. We'll go caroling. It should be a wonderful night of fellowship, so I hope you join us this Wednesday. Next Sunday, we'll have the children's program here at the 8:45 service, so look forward to that. We will also have what we call a Blue Christmas on December 21st. It'll be an opportunity for those who need some space to acknowledge their grief during the holidays and just to seek fellowship and healing together. So for those of you who are interested in that, join us on the 21st at 6 p.m. in the chapel, the Hester Chapel. Then Christmas Eve services, want to make sure you know there's three options, 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock, and 11 o'clock. So hope you'll come with your families on Christmas Eve and look forward to all the wonderful music of that evening. And then finally, we want to make sure you know on Christmas Day, the next morning, we're just going to have one service, 10 o'clock here at the sanctuary. Feel free to wear festive holiday sweaters and whatever. You can wear PJs. Just come and we'll have a wonderful day of celebration. We're going to sing lots of carols and just have a great day. But it'll only be one service at 10 o'clock. And to be clear also, I want to make sure you know on January 1st, we will not have in-person worship. We're going to record a special service and send it out to all of you and then let the staff have a little break on January 1st. So a lot of announcements, a lot of things going on, and glad you're here this morning. So let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Morning. We're not the Smith family. We light this candle as a symbol of Christ, who is our joy. May the promise of God's steadfast love and faithfulness cause us to rejoice. O come, Emmanuel.
Let us join together in our call to worship. As we embark on our Advent journey, we name the suffering in our nation and of our world, from the uncertainties and losses of the COVID-19 pandemic to the violence of war to the destruction of natural disasters. We are inundated by adversity and long for a Savior. As we wait for our rescue, we ask, how long, O Lord, how long? We name the sorrow and challenges in our neighborhoods, from anxiety about how to educate our children to the strain of public discourse riddled with malice instead of kindness, to the violence that makes neighbors afraid of their neighbors. We are surrounded by trouble and long for a shepherd. As we wait for our relief, we ask, how long, O Lord, how long? We name the worries and the strains in our homes, from the stresses of juggling child care, elder care, and full-time jobs to the concerns of how to make ends meet when we are already stretched thin, to the grief from all we have lost. We are overwhelmed by distress and long for the Prince of Peace. As we wait for our restoration, we ask, how long, O Lord, how long? How long, O Lord, how long until you rescue, relieve, and restore your people? Together we wait, and together we hope, as we seek wellness of body, mind, and emotions for ourselves and our neighbors. Amen.
Please stand.
Hail to the Lord's anointed, praise reign on earth begun. He comes to break oppression, to set the captive free, to take away transgression and rule in equity. He comes as son who speaks to those who suffer wrong, to help the poor. Prayer unceasing and daily vows of sin. shall stand forever, that name to us is love.
You may be seated.
Throughout the season of Advent, as we've been studying this journey together towards mental wellness, we've been using centering prayer as an opportunity to just check in on how we're doing. So I want to invite you to take a deep breath in and take a deep breath out as we welcome one another this morning. We also want to welcome everything that we're bringing with us today. So take a moment to close your eyes and to be still and to take another deep breath. What do you sense in your body? Does it feel sleepy or awake, tight or loose? What do you sense in your mind? Does it feel peaceful or restful, distressed or at ease? And what do you sense in your heart? Does it feel proud or downcast, sorrowful or joyful? And finally, what do you sense in your spirit? Does it feel broken or whole, abandoned or redeemed? However you are feeling this morning, you are welcome here, just as you are. Let us worship God together. Amen. I want to lift up a few things before I offer the pastoral prayer. Just want to remind you that if you come here this morning with something you would like to share, there are prayer cards in the pew that you can fill out and put in the offering plate. And Pastor Kim and I will pray over those and let us know if you'd like us to follow up with you. There are prayer requests printed in the bulletin as well. We have quite a few people recovering from surgeries. And so I want to also lift up Morgan Penner's father, Leland. He's in the hospital with some health issues. But pray for all those who've had surgery recently and are recovering. And also just know that Pastor Kim and I are available before and after the service if you'd like to talk with us and have a prayer with us. So let's take a moment now to pray in silence and lift up what's on our hearts. Emmanuel, we want to believe you are with us, dwelling in this and every moment. But we pine for the past and we rush towards the future. We want to be found wide awake, alert with love, as you appear to this and every moment. But we slumber through and laze away the miracle of ordinary days. We want to wait for you alone with desire and hope, but our trust fails and our longing grows cold and our hope dims. We want to make room in our hearts, a safe and warm place for you to be born, but we close our hearts and we harden them to you and to your people. So Lord, we confess our failures at love. We are sorry. We ask your forgiveness. In the name of the Prince of Peace, amen. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Are we done? Could I have the kids come up, please? Good morning, guys. How are you? Hello, everyone. How are we doing today? Good. Great job singing. Good job singing and playing. All right, okay, so this Advent, this Christmas time, we've been talking about emotions and how there are good emotions and there are hard emotions, right? And all of those things are just a part of being human. But one of the things that's really hard is when there's a person who's constantly over and over experiencing hard emotions. And they don't ever get a break, and they don't have anybody to support them through those emotions, especially at Christmas time. All right, so I brought some things with me to help you guys understand this, and I'm gonna probably need some help with this. Okay, so I've got my bag here, and then I also have some rocks, and I have some cotton balls. Okay, so the cotton balls are going to represent things that are good or easy in our lives, okay? And the rocks are going to represent maybe things that are a little bit harder. Okay, so we're going to start, and we're going to talk about like a day that some of you might have. Okay, we're going to start Monday. All right, so we're going to say that you start the day kind of stressed because you can't find your lunchbox. All right, so we're going to put a rock in our bag here. All right, so after that, it was a little bit stressful because you were late to school, but during PE, you were playing soccer and you scored a goal. Yes, put that in there. And then you felt really proud because your parent or your friends all cheered for you. Yes, all right. And then everything was okay during the day, but so you got home at night and you found out that your grandma was sick, and so she was not going to be able to come to watch you play soccer that weekend. Okay, so that was a little bit harder, so we're gonna put some more rocks in. But what was good is your mom gave you a hug, and she reminded you that your grandma loves you, and she helped you kind of think of ways to show your grandma that you love her. Okay, so that was your day. So, Lisa, will you help me? Will you put this bag on? Okay, are you able to carry it? I mean, does it feel very heavy?
No.
Not heavy at all. Okay, so it was an okay day. Okay, let me have the bag back. Okay, so we're going to empty this bag out, and we're going to talk about maybe a day that someone else at school had. It was a little bit harder. And they didn't have a lot of support. Okay, so let's see what happens first. Okay, your friend wakes up Monday morning and they're worried because there really isn't enough to eat in the house. Now that's a whole different situation than maybe you were just late to school. Okay, so we've got a bigger rock in there. Okay, so then when you were waiting for the bus, you were sad because you were cold. And you knew it was going to be a while before your family was able to buy a coat because you had to wait till the next payday. Ugh. Being cold and being hungry is really different than just being late to school. Okay, so when you get to school, you were happy because you got to see your friends. That's good. Cotton balls going in. And then in math, you realize you forgot your homework because you were cold and because you were worried about your food. And so you just totally forgot it. And to make things worse, there were kids that were making fun of you because you forgot your homework. Okay, so you got home and you were happy because your mom was there and you got to talk to her for a while. But then she had to go to work. And so you were really sad because you knew she wasn't going to be there with you. That's a lot of emotions going on and a lot of hard stuff. Okay, Liesl. Okay, what does that feel like? Tell us. It's really heavy, isn't it? Okay, now, you could probably carry that, right? But how would it be to carry that all the time? Would it make it hard? It would be annoying. Would it make it hard for you to, like, think and do homework and all that kind of stuff, right? Because you would be carrying something really hard. Well, you know, especially around the holidays, sometimes people are carrying really, really heavy loads like this. And there's a lot of hard things going on in their life. That's pretty heavy, isn't it, Bron? Yeah. And you know what? God wants us to help the people in our community who are hurting. Man, that's heavy. Sometimes to help other people, it means we would actually be able to, like, provide food or provide clothes or actually help them solve the problem. But sometimes there's nothing we can do to help people solve a problem. Sometimes what we have to do is just, we have to be there and we have to help them carry the load. So, okay, Lisa, will stand up. And Lily, will you stand up too? Okay, what would it be like if you guys both held that backpack? Would it be a little easier? Okay, so I want you guys, thank you, I want you guys to be looking this Christmas season for people that you can help. Sometimes it's just listening to them, or sometimes it's just being a friend. And that will help them carry the heavy loads that they have. And sometimes we don't even know what kinds of loads people are carrying, but just be watching. And it'll usually help you guys too. Okay, so since we talked about heavy rocks, I brought you all some special rocks. And they say, it says love others on the back. And so I hope you guys will remember that this Christmas. So you guys each get to take one to remember to help carry the loads of others. Do you guys want to pray with me really quick before we go back? You don't even have to sit down. All right, are we good? Did everybody get one? They're all different and they're fun, aren't they? All right, let's pray. God, thank you for our emotions, both the good and the hard ones. Please help us to notice, listen, and help people around us when they are struggling. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys.
We are extra blessed this morning with music. My goodness. Today's reading is from the Gospel of Luke. Listen for the word of God. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Have you ever noticed a connection you share with other sports fans? If you're a Kansas City Chiefs fan, you automatically have a story to share with others wearing the logo. In the grocery store, you can say to a complete stranger, "What about them Chiefs?" And immediately, you're engaged in a conversation, sharing victories or the misery of a spoiled play. Sports fans as a whole are made up of individuals who gather in community together. The guys with no shirts on, painted red, standing in the cold. And this community of fans screaming and booing together. There is an electrifying sense of connection and community through this shared experience. The crowd, in person or watching on a screen, becomes part of a greater purpose for the love of the team. And I wonder how the meaning of Christmas might be the same. Let us pray. God of connection, surround us as your disciples, waiting to celebrate the birth of the baby Jesus. Help us as the body of Christ to find meaning through the larger purpose of Christmas. Teach us today through your holy word. Amen. Today is the third sermon in the series for Advent, Journey Towards Mental Wellness. This is based on a resource from the United Methodist Health Ministry Fund office in Hutchinson, Kansas. There is a special connection with our church. Members of Trinity serve on the board and helped develop this resource for other churches to use. This material is much needed in this season of life, focusing on mental health post-COVID pandemic. In the first week, Pastor Michael shared how we can improve mental health by speaking up and asking for help, offering support, talking about mental health issues, and turning to God in prayer. The following week, we learned about the importance of active listening and how to be fully present with others, which can help improve our mental health. We have learned to honor our own emotions and compassionately listen to the emotions and stories of others. And today, we will explore how community helps us build up and enact hope together so that all of us can live in mental wellness. Let's learn from today's gospel story and identify some players on God's team. We hear about the shepherds living in the fields and keeping watch over the flocks by night. We don't know how many shepherds were there, but we do know that they were doing the same work they did every night. We do not know about their mental health or some of the burdens that they shared. I don't think a shepherd's wage was something to brag about. Were they hungry? Were they separated from their family as they cared for the flock? This could have been a very lonely job. Maybe looking at the sky was hard because things on earth seemed hopeless. Yet, these shepherds became part of the miracle of Christmas, bringing hope to the world and the message we still hear today, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son so that all may have life eternal. Do you remember that innkeeper that sent Mary and Joseph away when there was no room in the inn? There was no hospitality, no welcome. Bethlehem was overcrowded, and the local residents and visitors alike were unwilling or unable to receive Jesus when he was born. Did the innkeeper feel a sense of guilt as he walked outside and looked up and actually saw a multitude of angels? Did the locals experience the heavenly proclamation of Jesus' birth? The shepherds, the innkeeper, the locals, the animals, all of them were connected by the love of God and the birth of the Son Jesus. They were all on the same team that night. They became a community influenced by a multitude of heavenly hosts. My first point is about our journey towards mental wellness, which is that we need to be part of a community. We need one another to heal and be whole. We build communities together. As we all know, our society is fragmented, and the breakdown of the family has taken its toll. Many are experiencing this nagging sense of emptiness. An emptiness described as being rooted in the malignancy of our profound disconnection, as described in Todd Hall's book, The Connected Life. Hall names the collective story of relationships and spiritual disconnections and the search for meaning in a broken, lonely world. In our homes, in our communities, we are dealing with a profound separation from one another. We are often also disconnected from ourselves as we keep running away from dealing with those emotional issues when our hearts are broken. Some of us don't even know what to feel anymore. We're disconnected from one another as we use social media to unfriend each other. We don't even have to see the pain in somebody else's eyes. Just click send. We're disconnected as families, building walls rather than bridges to those critical people in our lives. Yes, families are messy, yet those relationships are valuable. We are called to forgive one another and work through those differences. Author Todd Hall proposes that we cultivate this deep sense of meaning that comes from being connected with God and others. And yes, sometimes it's a lot of work to keep loving connections with one another, even in the church. Do you know that sometimes we disagree and offend one another? Just like in your own family, it's important to stay engaged and work through the issues rather than disconnecting from one another. Some of us have not come back to church in person after COVID. Sitting comfortably in the easy chair watching worship services at a convenient time. It is much simpler not to travel to the church building and put up with those weird people in the church, just like us. The Apostle Paul wrote in Hebrews 10, "Let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting the meeting together as a habit of some, but encouraging one another." Your church needs you. We all sense a sense of community that we can find in the church with other believers. We share deep, holy experiences when we worship together, when we celebrate baptisms. Do you remember seeing that proud family up front as they vow to raise their child up in the faith? It does your heart good. Have you been here when we have mourned together, when we have lost a beloved brother or sister in Christ? And as we mourn together, we also help one another. We pick up that backpack of heavy rocks and we take them out one at a time for one another. We take out rocks together in our community, through the soup kitchen, feeding the hungry. We help clothe others through the Fair Price clothing store. We're making a wonderful Christmas happy and joyful for a student in need this Christmas season. Community helps us carry the load together. My second point is about the journey towards mental wellness is that we need to belong. We are healed when we belong to something outside of ourselves. Now, people born before 1946 are almost twice as likely as Gen Xers to feel a sense of belonging and connection to their neighborhood, church, or local community or groups that they belong to. Our society is losing structures that once brought people together. People socialize less, they trust less, yet our sense of meaning and purpose as we live out our lives is found in community when we belong. And that belonging helps us thrive and grow in our faith. In the Christmas story, everybody went to tell the good news of the birth of the Christ child. Everybody was involved. The shepherds went to find Mary and Joseph. And the scripture said when they saw this, they were amazed. And they went off glorifying and praising God for all they had seen. They went to tell others about their experience. Other people began to belong to this miracle. And they shared hope. Active hope communicates that we are not simply sitting around waiting for God to bring about wellness that we need. Active hope means that we are participating in the work of God, working with God in the world, acting as agents of hope towards flourishing and the wellness of all our neighbors. So this gospel calls us to action. It imagines what flourishing would look like for those who are suffering, and it calls us into this broken world. Christ's birth helps us imagine how we can be community that acts in hope. We can journey towards mental wellness and thrive when we belong and we work together. Christmas hope is shown through the darkness to everybody present that day and today. God's love is born anew in our hearts right here, right now, leading us to hope. We are born to connect and be community. We need to belong. We're on the same team, experiencing Christmas hope together. Amen.
The ushers will come forward now to receive the offering. And the offering is an opportunity for us to respond to the many gifts that God's given us with gratitude and joy and praise. Let us pray. God, who gives all gifts, in this season, we focus so much on giving gifts to one another. Help us that we might bear fruit worthy of the very heart of this season, fruit of compassion, fruit of sharing, fruit by denying ourselves so that others who have little will have enough. In response to you, we give that a fruit might please you. In the Savior's name we pray. Amen.
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem.
Bow for the benediction. As you leave this space today, take a moment to breathe in and breathe out. Now receive this blessing and all the emotions you brought here today and all the emotions you carry out of this place and in all the emotions you experience this week. We do not journey through life alone. May God bless you with compassionate ears and holy imaginations that are ready to participate in God's work to make mental wellness and flourishing possible for all our neighbors. Amen.